5, verses 18 through 21. Let's read those verses. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 18 through 21. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody with your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks for all things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to God, even the Father, and be subject to one another in the fear of Christ. Lord, this is your word. And we need you, Holy Spirit, to minister God's word to our hearts, to change us, to make us more like you. So, Lord, that's what we're asking this morning. Speak to us. Minister to us, Lord. Change us. Have your way in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, Jesus, before this, had told the disciples that they are the light of the world. He also told them, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. And it is you and I who are born-again believers in Jesus Christ who shine the truth to this world, which is a dark world. It's an evil place, not paradise. A world that is really on its way to hell. Quickly. So Ephesians 5 is encouraging you and I to be that light in a dark world. You know what it's like to go into a room at night, and it's completely dark, and you hit the switch, boom, we're in the darkness, boom, it's gone. And you and I are that light, His light, shining to this world. So that people would see God, they would see Jesus, and not the darkness of the world. You know, verse 8 of Ephesians 5, it said, for you were formerly darkness, that's you and I, we were formerly darkness, but now you are the light in the Lord. Walk as children of the light. When I gave my life to Jesus, when I started walking with the Lord, I gave my life to Jesus long before I started walking with the Lord. There's a difference. Oh, Lord, forgive me my sin. I'm saved. You know, then go back and do your own thing. It's not quite like walking with the Lord, hand in hand, through this life, following Him, obeying Him, reading His Word, spending time in prayer, being in fellowship, walking with Him. It's completely different. When you walk with Him, you will be the light. Now, when you're saved, you can be a dim light. Now in verse 18, He's going to give us the ability to be that light and to shine that light in this world. He's going to give us the ability. This will open the door for you and I for a new life in Christ. The things that He said here. Jesus gave us a promise in Acts chapter 1, verse 8. He said this, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you should be my witnesses, both in Jerusalem, and in Judea, and in Samaria, and even to the remotest part of the earth. And that actually even means belief. Or in kind village. By the way, I love that time. It's still my favorite place in the world. Say hi to the people around here. Oh, excuse me, just got snow yesterday. So. So you will be that light wherever you go. The remotest part of the world. Wherever you go, you'll be that light. Now there's one commandment about the Holy Spirit. One commandment about the Holy Spirit. And it's here in verse 18 of Ephesians 5, where it says, and do not get drunk with wine, for that is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit. Now, you know, you will be filled with the Spirit. So why don't I go over to Publix over here, you know, and buy a bottle full of Spirit, water Spirit. Well, we'll talk about that in a little bit. See, this is the key to shining the light. It's the key to a victorious life. know, so many of us as Christians, we lead such defeated lives, you know, we struggle so many. We all have struggles, right? But some of us have just struggles with so much sin in our lives that keep falling on our face. Well, the key to overcoming that is in the Scripture. Be filled with the Spirit. So in this command, he's telling us a few things. He tells us two things. What we must avoid and what we must do. What must we avoid? Do not be drunk with wine, for that is dissipation. I mean, you know, it's kind of interesting. Here you got this book of Ephesians, we're going through all this stuff, and then out of nowhere, it says, do not be drunk with wine. I mean, why? Well, good possibility is because the furthest thing from being filled with the Spirit is being drunk with wine. That's as far away from it as you can get. That means rum too, beer, alcohol. It's the opposite of being filled with the Spirit. See, drunkenness is just completely sold out to the desires of the flesh. Me, what I want. When you see a drunk, they're all about themselves. They're not about anybody else. They're all about themselves. It's giving yourself over to that old nature that when you were born again, when Jesus came and lived in your life, died, was crucified with Christ. It's giving completely over to nature. No holds barred, no restraint. If it feels good, do it. Here's the problem with that. Here's the danger of that. Dissipation. And that is dissipation. The word dissipation in the Greek is asotia. Something like that. I don't speak Greek that well. I have a hard time speaking English, you know. But the root word comes from the word sotia, which means save. To save. To look after. To keep. To care for. And the A on add on there is a negative. It means not to. Not to save. Not to take care of. To throw away. Not to keep. To squander and throw away in a foolish manner. That's dissipation. That's getting drunk with wine. Include that with drugs. Of any sort. From marijuana all the way down. Oh, marijuana's not a drug. Yes, it is. I've been for years. I know what kind of drug it is. I was addicted to it. No, it's not addicted. Yes, it is. I couldn't wake up in the morning without that much of a joint. You know? If I didn't, yeah, it wasn't like I was going to die. That's all I thought about. It was maybe the addiction wasn't totally physical, but it probably was, partially. But it sure was mental. I couldn't do anything without smoking a joint. What do you do? Where do you go to movies day? Well, who's got the doobies, man? Let's roll them up so we can watch the movie while we're loading. But anyway, man, I'm smoking a joint first so I can enjoy the food more. The furthest away from being filled with the Spirit. It's the word used for the prodigal son. The prodigal son, when he threw away his inheritance and wasted it. It's the same word. You know, really the point is you can't be worldly and be filled with the Spirit. You just can't be worldly and be filled with the Spirit. There's not enough room. Either you're filled with the Spirit or you're not. Galatians 5:17 says, for the flesh sets its desire against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. For these that are opposition to one another, so you may not do the things that you please. See, they're in direct opposition to one another. The Spirit and the flesh. Your flesh. Your flesh wants to do stuff. It's your flesh that causes you to stumble. It's your flesh that says, come on, man, you gotta have it. It's your flesh that, when you're hungry, growls. It's not the Spirit in you that's going, you're hungry. It's your stomach going, rawr, rawr. No. That's flesh. That's why fasting is such a great thing to do, because when you fast, you deny the flesh to the utmost. Because there's one thing you want to do every day, that's eat. And I know how your believings are. Oh my goodness. gotta be, boom, 12 o'clock at 5, or you know, it's right. 12 noon, don't talk to me, I'm eating. I mean, you can have a nail, and you know, you out build a house, you can have a nail right here, boom, whoop, whoop, you drop the hammer. 12 o'clock. Right? So what I have to say is, what about fasting? What do you do in your fast? You know, it's, that's denying the flesh to the most. And it's such a great thing to do, because when you do that, as soon as you're hungry, you can pray. You can get in the Word, you know, and it reminds you to fellowship with the Lord when you get hungry like that. And then the pains go away after a while. Then they come back. And when you fast for 3 days, by the third day, you're almost kind of okay. You know, you're not starving yet. Yeah, God will speak to you. But you know, that's another study. There's that battle that goes on inside of every one of us. Even me, you guys, as your pastor. I deal with the flesh too, you know that? I don't walk around floating on a cloud like, there comes me, man, I'm old. I deal with the flesh too. Ask Mr. Roberti when he works for me. He's kind of went out, wait, you know, now, he's going to do it this way. You know, poor guy, he's just doing my flesh all the time. But I love him anyhow. He loves me. I know he probably in his mind he goes, put up. There's an old American Indian that described the battle between the flesh and the spirit like two dogs fighting against each other. And he says, you know which one is stronger? The one you feed. And there's two dogs, you feed one, you don't feed the other one. Try that for about a week. And then you want to get a fight. You know, one dog is eating, he's got to win. Now let's talk about your flesh. You feed your flesh. Your flesh is you. The stuff you want to do. Man, I'm going to go party down. I'm going to do this. I'm going to, you know, that's me. Yeah. You know, that's the flesh. Wanting this, wanting that. You. Me. And if you feed those desires and you do those things, it's hard for the spirit to help you run your life. It's hard for you to have victory over the sin in your life because you fed the flesh. That's what wins in your life. But if you feed the Spirit of God who lives inside of you, that's who will win. Well, how do I feed the Spirit of God, Pastor Jim? By reading the Bible? By denying yourself from that stuff that you desire in the flesh? By spending time in prayer? By being in fellowship? By obeying the Lord? By being filled with the Spirit? That's how you do it. And when you give up those things in the flesh, you're getting something much better. See, people in the world don't think that. People in the world think that when you become a Christian, you know, you have all of a sudden you have all these rules you must follow. Can't do this, can't do that, can't. You know what? It's not a matter of you can't do those things. You don't have to do them anymore. You're not a slave to drugs, alcohol, and sex, and things in the world. You're not a slave anymore because you've been set free. You don't have to do those things, and you can do things that are so much better for you and last eternally, not just for the moment. It will not kill you. Of course, unless you get persecuted, so the option is your Christian. It's coming one day. Be filled with the Spirit. How many stories have you heard in your lifetime, especially in the States, of, you know, young people that, you know, have something really going for them, a free ride in college or something, man, and they went out and did something stupid in the flesh and blew it, went out and thieved or something. I mean, just in this last couple years, you know, I'm a NFL football fan. I like to watch professional football. And you watch some of these young guys come out of college that are just gifted, great football players, and do something stupid. There was two of them, the Kansas City Chiefs, that the one guy gave up. This guy was a running back. This guy, he's going to make millions of dollars. I mean, he is set for life. But what did he do? He beat some woman up in a hotel room. And guess what? He got canned. He lost it. He'll be lucky to come back and play. And then one of their wide receivers, you know, had child abuse or something. Their spousal abuse in his wife, and he's got problems now. By being in the flesh, by following the things of the flesh. ruin lives. God has so much more for us. So be filled with the Spirit and not be drunk with wine. Now, I want to talk a little bit about that. Some of my personal feelings on there, okay? About not being drunk with wine. Aside from the alcohol issue, there's churches in the world say, you can't drink any alcohol at all. The Bible obviously is clear that, you know, you can have a glass of wine. There's no word that says you cannot do that. Just don't be drunk for it. So we don't tell you you can't do it. But I don't think it's okay to be. Because, for me, in my own opinion, and for myself, I just stay away from alcohol altogether. Because, number one, it's not going to do anything for me but leave me into trouble if I do. Because, you know what, for me, I'm not very good with willpower. I was a drug addict. I love drugs. I was not good with willpower. So, if I have a drink, I'm going to have another one. And I like that feeling. So, I'm going to have another. So, I just completely stay away from it. And not only that, for me personally, as a pastor, I think it's a poor witness. And moving here to Belize and understanding that most of the people in Belize believe that if you drink, you're not a Christian. And I've had people come to me with different teams that came here, and people on teams are drinking, and people come to me and say, well, they're not Christians because they drink and they smoke, so they're not Christians. And the people are stubborn when you do that. So I say, you don't need it. Why even do it? Why? They don't, you know, if you do it, somebody sees you and they think you're not Christian. What if I'm out at the local place and I'm over Ivy Shore, and there's some alcoholics there, which we have many alcoholics in this peninsula, and they know I'm a pastor, you know, and I'm there and I'm having a beer. Maybe I'm just having one beer, if I like it, so I'm not going to. But they're going to look and say, well, you're just like us, it must be okay, and they get drunk, and I stumble them. It can be a stumbling block for people. So I say, as a Christian, you know, if you really have to have it, you know, go in your closet home and have a drink. But why bother? Why just stumble anybody? That's my personal opinion. If I see you on having a drink, I'm not going to say anything to you, and I'm not going to go, oh, you know. I'm just telling you my take on it, my experience. There's things in my life that you can stumble me with. Probably the worst thing in the world for me is I like to gamble. My first probably vice was gambling. Waiting for drugs and alcohol and sex. Right, I knew what those things were. My dad started me gambling when I was 5 years old. Gambling on racehorses in the States. And then my dad, when I was 15, 16 years old, taking me to Las Vegas to the casinos and gambling. And so, and then I moved to Lake Tahoe, and it's one of the gambling capitals in the world. In Las Vegas, we got Reno, and Lake Tahoe, and the man, Miss Anna, I went there, we were walking with the Lord, and I'd blow money every night, man. I go to the casino every night, limiting myself to a certain amount of money every night. And then when I started walking with the Lord, I repented. I quit gambling. You're having a little poker game, man. I don't know if you're doing it, because it brings you right back to that place. And one time we're out having dinner with my pastor in Reno. And everywhere in Reno, there's slot machines everywhere, you know. You go to Marie Callender's, and there's a slot machine as you walk out the door that you can put a coin in or something and win a free pie. But my pastor, you know, he's got this coin. Yeah, let's see if we can win a free pie, you know. He's got some, they give you a token to get you started for free, right? He puts it in, I go, you're stumbling with me, man. It was fun to say that to him. You're stumbling with me, man. Gambling's my, that's my, of course I wasn't a gambler, but you know, I let him have it. They feel terrible. He still loves me. So you don't want to stumble somebody. That is so important. So important. So that's my take on it. Now, that's between you and the Lord. And I don't look down on you for whatever you do. We're saved by grace. There's grace in our lives. You know, I don't legalistic at all. So I find it. But Proverbs 20, verse 1 says, wine is a mocker, strong drink a brawler, and whoever is intoxicated by it is not wise. So in other words, if you're a drinker, you need to get drunk, into whatever. Sorry. Be filled with the Spirit. Don't be under the controlling influence of anything but the Holy Spirit in your life. Nothing else. When the church was born in Acts, that's where the church started. In second chapter of Acts. Guess what? They were filled with the Holy Spirit. That's when the church was born. That's when Jesus himself by the Holy Spirit came and lived inside of you as a Christian. Before that, the Holy Spirit did not live in people. The Holy Spirit came upon people. What did that mean? It says in Acts chapter 2. I think it's verse 1. I got here. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly there came from heaven a noise like a violent rushing wind. And it filled the whole house where they were sitting. And there appeared to them tongues of fire distributing themselves. And they rested on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. And began to speak with other tongues, and the Spirit was giving them utterance. So the Spirit, when the church was born, came upon them, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, interesting thing about that is, before that, they were a bunch of chickens. When Jesus got crucified, they all ran and hid, didn't they? They split. I mean, even Peter, the little girl, said, you're one of his. I swear by heaven, I don't know. And now this happens, and he gets to stand up in front of those same people who crucified Jesus Christ and preach the gospel at him. Because why? Because they were filled with the Holy Spirit. They were the same people, but they were filled with the Holy Spirit, so they weren't afraid anymore. Don't you want that kind of power in your life? Don't you want that in your life? Some of the people said this in Acts 2:13. They said, but others were mocking and saying, they're full of sweet wine. In other words, they're drunk. This is the way they're acting. They're speaking in tongues. They're like, whoa. Not only that, they're speaking in tongues of people have been visiting from all over in Jerusalem, and they've been visiting because it's that time of year when they came for their feast, and they heard these guys in their different languages. They're drunk. Well, Peter answered and said in Acts 2:14, says, but Peter, taking his stand with the 11, raised his voice and declared, the men of Judea and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you. Give heed to my words, for these men are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only the third hour of the day. But this is what was spoken of by the prophet Joel. And it shall be the last day, God says, that I will pour forth my spirit on all mankind. And your sons and daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even on my bondslaves, both men and women, I will in those days pour forth my spirit, and they shall prophesy. That is being spirit-filled. The same thing that God wants for you. That's why he says it here in Ephesians. Be filled with the Spirit. He wants you to be filled like those disciples were filled. So you can stand up and proclaim the gospel, or whatever that is in your life, or pull teeth and be filled with the Spirit, you know, full of prophecy, clean their teeth nicely. Yes. It's a supernatural thing. It's something that God does to you. You don't make it up. It's not something you do. He does it to you. It says in Acts 4:8, Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said. He was filled with the Holy Spirit. It's something the Lord does for you. You can ask him, fill me with your spirit, he will do it. Acts 4:31, it says, and when they had prayed, the place where they had gathered together was shaken, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak the word of God in boldness. Do you want to speak the word of God? Do you want to have power in your life? Share your testimony in the gospel. Be filled. It should be part of your life. Not just, you know, when it says be filled, the word actually means to be continually filled. It's not something one time you do it. It means do it. Be continually filled. Lord, fill me with your spirit. Because guess what? You drain out. Fill me again. You drain out. You fill me again. You don't eat one time and then don't eat again. If you did, you'd be dead. In Acts 6:3 and 4, it says, therefore, brethren, select from among you 7 men of good reputation, full of the Spirit and wisdom, whom we may put in charge of this task, but we would devote ourselves to prayer and the ministry of the word. See, they needed somebody to do the work of the ministry. So somebody that would take care of the orphans and the widows, and to serve the tables, you know, and to sweep the floors and to paint the toilets and to put the words up, you know. They needed somebody like that. So what did they look for? They looked for men who were, and women, who were filled with the Spirit. They looked for men and women who were filled with the Spirit, because that was the qualification. Men who live it, okay? Men who live it. You know, in Acts chapter 6, verse 54 to 60, you know, I'm just going to tell you about it. I'm not going to read all that. I'm just going to tell you about it. Stephen was one of those men they picked. And then Stephen had the boldness to stand up before all these people and share the gospel and tell, you crucified Jesus. And guess what? They wanted to kill him. And they were defiled. And he looked up, you know, my paraphrase, he looked up in heaven, he saw Jesus, and whoa, the heavens are, I see Jesus standing at the right hand of the Father. And when they looked at him, he looked like an angel. He was filled with the Spirit. He looked like an angel. And he started stoning him. They started to kill him with rocks. That's what stoning means. Start throwing rocks at him. That's how they killed people back then. They stoned him until their skulls were crushed or whatever happened. And it says this. It says, then they went on stoning Stephen, and he called out the Lord and said, Lord, receive my spirit. Then falling on his knees, he cried out with a loud voice, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. But he fell asleep and died. They're killing him, and he said, Lord, forgive him. Just like Jesus did. Be filled with the Spirit. Well, that's Ephesians chapter 5. That was the first verse. Next, a few more. The rest of it won't take long. Then in verse 19, it says, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing, making melody with your heart to the Lord. You know, when you are filled with the Spirit, there's an inner transformation. You're changed inside. There's a peace, there's a joy that goes beyond understanding. And you can make melody here, you can sing. You know, when we come in here, and we sing, because we sing a lot in this church. For those of you just visiting, you can tell. You might say, well, that's the last song. We keep singing. We love worship the Lord. We love to make melody in our hearts. We love to speak to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, because that's what we're doing. Love to do that. You'll have an inner joy in the Lord in your heart when you're filled with the Spirit. People can seem so happy on the outside, be empty on the inside. So be a spirit-filled Christian. And when there's times that there's really hard, sad times, get the joy of the Lord in your life. Peace of the Lord. And many of you, I've shared my testimony so many times of when I was paralyzed, how that happened in my life. Here I was paralyzed and happier than most people who visit me, they do whatever they want. I couldn't go to the bathroom by myself. I was happy with me. I had peace. I was filled with the Spirit. And you know when you're down, sometimes, start to praise the Lord. Begin to sing to the Lord. Make melody in your heart. Watch how the Lord transforms you on the inside. Verse 20. Always giving thanks for all things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to God, even the Father. And being filled, look up and say, thank you, Lord. Thank you that I'm saved. Thank you that I can worship the Lord freely in my country, in my village. Thank you, Lord, that you love me. Thank you, Lord. Be filled with it. Thank you, Lord. Be grateful for what he's done for you. Because he has so many promises for you. Then in verse 21, the last verse. See how quickly I got to those? Yeah. See, I get with it. And be subject to one another in the fear of Christ. See, when you are filled with the Holy Spirit, then you can be subject and you can submit to one another. And remember, what, 2 weeks ago I told you guys, last week we're going to get into, okay? I said, last week we're going to be into, why is he subject to your husband's wife? And there was Mother's Day, I said, we're not going there. We're going there next week, okay? That's the next verse. But see, it's submitting to one another. It's not just that. It's submitting to one another. You don't have to have your own way. Let the Lord take care of it for you. You don't have to get rebuilt. You don't have to have this. You don't have to let the Lord deal with that. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. Let Him fill you. He will not force it on you. The Holy Spirit doesn't come to you and say, "Move out of the way, I'm coming in." Be nice if you did, probably. You're probably better off if you did it that way, probably wouldn't have a choice, right? He gives us a choice if you feel it or not. But He doesn't force it on you. You surrender your will to Him and ask for His will to be done in your life. And ask to be filled with the Holy Spirit and receive it by faith. Now, just quickly, I'm going to go through this. There are two views of that in the church today about being filled with the Holy Spirit, being baptized in the Holy Spirit. You got, the Pentecostals, they're way to that side. And you got, real traditional churches, they're way to that side. So you got to stump them both, so bring them to the middle and balance them out. Okay? So the two views is when you ask Jesus in your heart to fill the Holy Spirit. The other view is the Spirit comes upon you. We believe that when you invite Jesus in your heart, the Spirit comes and lives in you. Okay? There's three parts or three things that the Holy Spirit does in your life. Here they are. Number one is para. The Holy Spirit is with you. Before you are born again, before you receive Jesus in your life, the Spirit of God is with you. That's why you get convicted, you hear the truth, you know it's the truth, because the Holy Spirit's trying to draw you to Jesus. He's with you. And then you come to a place in your life where you surrender your life, you realize, Jesus, you died on the cross, you shed your blood for your sin. I need you in my life. I believe grossly that I need you, Lord. You're my ticket. You're the way, the truth, the life. I believe in my heart. Boom! And boom, the Holy Spirit comes and lives in you, and that word is in. So, first the Holy Spirit is with you, now the Holy Spirit is in you. And then there's a third part, which is talking about being filled with the Holy Spirit, and the word is epi, to come upon you. Kind of like being under a water faucet and turning it on. Whoosh! Just overflowing in you, just coming upon you. That's what you continually ask for. The Holy Spirit's living in you. Last night, as I prayed before I went to sleep about the message this morning, I woke up this morning before I come here, I said, "Lord, give me number one, before you can be filled with the Holy Spirit, you need to empty out, you need to confess your sin. If you're harboring something, there's some sin that you just keep in there, you can never be completely filled with the Holy Spirit because it's in the way." In other words, if I have a glass of orange juice, well, I can't fill it with water because there's orange juice, so I have to pour the orange juice out to fill it with water, right? So if there's things in your life that aren't right, you need to get rid of them, confess them, ask for forgiveness, and He is faithful to forgive you just like that. Boom, forgiven. Just get the Lord forgiven. Wham. You're empty. The sin is gone. That also means those little closets that you're not dealing with. No, I confess this, I confess that. But that one I'm still going to hold on to because I don't want to give it up. That means that one too. Confess it. You repent from it. You turn from it. Then you're empty. So guess what? When you say, "Lord, fill me with the Holy Spirit," guess what He does? He fills you with the Holy Spirit. And when that happens, it's not like all of a sudden your eyes start turning around. Woo-hoo, man, I'm filled with the Holy Spirit. But it's not that. You believe it with your whole heart. You ask, and you receive it, and you say, "Lord, I believe You fill me. Before I came here today, Lord, fill me with the Holy Spirit so I can speak forth Your word in truth and boldness. Because if You don't, Lord, I got nothing off. You have to do it, I can't do it." You can say, "I'm going to go play music somewhere. Lord, fill us with Your Holy Spirit." Before the worship team in the morning, before we rehearse, we pray. And usually one of the things they say is, "Lord, forgive us our sins, search our hearts, and fill us afresh with Your Holy Spirit." And I pray for that for us. I pray continually, because the word is continually be filled with the Holy Spirit. And watch how God uses. Watch how His word, all of a sudden, you want to read it, and it becomes alive to you. And watch how you even understand it, because you're filled with the Holy Spirit. If you sit down and read the word, "Oh, this is boring, man. I can't understand this." Well, stop, repent, confess, ask to be filled, and then read it. And after you're filled, say, Lord, I'm just going to believe you filled me because you said you wanted me to fill, and it's your will to be done. And you receive it. And believe it or not, you need it to get through this world. And if you're not doing it, your walk is probably not doing very well. You're compromising, you're struggling, you've got no power, you're embarrassed to share the things of God, you don't even know how to, the word's boring to you, you're doing things you shouldn't do, you're not filled with Spirit. You want to change life? Jordan's always saying, Jordan's always talking about change, 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 change. Where there's no change unless Jesus comes and fills you with the Spirit. You guys can do it all you want, but if God doesn't do it, sorry. That's where the change comes from. And it starts right here in this room with you and I. Not with them, with you and I. In the church down the street, it starts with them. It starts with God's people. And then the change comes. Once your village healed, the Bible says, if my people who are called by my name will repent, will pray, will confess their sin, stop doing the stuff they're doing, and turn to me and walk with me, I will heal their village. It says my people. It's not saying those who aren't his people. It's saying the church, those who are born again, who are compromised and walk, who are not walking with the Lord. Those people, us. We don't do that, your village isn't changing. Sorry. Yeah, it's going to change, all right. They're going to come and level one day and go to Hyatt here. That's not the change we want. We want to see people know the Lord in your village and say that. And love the Lord and be blessed by the Lord. But it takes us a place to start. Father, even now, Lord, we ask, as a body of believers here, Lord, forgive us of our sin, Lord. Forgive us of our lust, and our lying and cheating and adultery and fornication, Lord. Our thieving, our attitudes, Lord. Our pride. Forgive us, Lord. As we know that you shed your blood on the cross so that we can be forgiven. I pray for us, Lord, that our hearts are open to you right now, Lord, that you would forgive us. Because we believe in you, Lord. We believe in your promises. And now, Lord, I pray that as we've done that, Lord, that you would fill every one of us now with your Holy Spirit. And Lord, we receive that and we believe it because you say it in your word. So we receive it and believe it. So now use us, Lord. I pray. Personally, Lord, I pray for my brothers and sisters here that somehow if they've really done that, you will show them today, Lord. You will show them the world will come more alive, or something will happen in their lives. Whoa, something happened here. Something's different. It's the Holy Spirit. Living this Holy Spirit filled life. And so we go before us, Lord, and remind us to confess and to be filled with the Holy Spirit every day, during the day, and at night before we go to bed, for the rest of our lives, Lord. So that we can be used like you used Peter. Use Paul like you use those who walk with the Lord. We want to be used by you so people can know you. Have your way in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hey, let's stand and sing one more song, okay?
Bless you. Hang out and meet our visitors from the States. You want to go to an office?